Good morning and a blessed Sunday to you all. You may be seated. Our God is a good God who forgives our sins and sets us free. Let us thank God as we sing chorus number 214. God is so good. So many good things in our lives, and we have to be always thankful and grateful to Him. Let's sing chorus number 5. Give thanks with a grateful heart. And be glad in it. Let us sing chorus number 420. This is the day that the Lord has made. Christ in our lives. Every day is a happy day. Let us sing chorus number 450. I'm happy today. Just pray. Loving Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for bringing us into your presence once again to praise and worship you. We thank you for loving and forgiving us. Pray for our guidance and protection. Direct our paths and teach us to do the right things. Help us to always be in the center of your will and bring honor to your name. Shower down your blessings and give us the strength and hope to face the future with courage. This I ask in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Jaden, for leading us into this time of worship in such a meaningful way. Shall we all stand? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed be God.
Blessed be God.
John chapter 17, verse 17 says, sanctify them by the truth. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. Blessed be God. Shall we all say together the prayer of preparation found on page 7? Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom all secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of our Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthy magnify your holy name. Page 13, the summary of the law. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second commandment is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.
Amen.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us therefore confess our sins in penitence and in faith. Let us keep a moment of silence for personal confessions. God grant unto you pardon and remission of all your sins, timeliness of life, and the grace and comfort of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Shall we all rise and sing the Gloria together?
Thank you.
Shall we spend some time in silence for closing our prayers? To call it for today. Grant, Lord, that we may see you as revealed in the Holy Bible, the fulfillment of our need, and may turn from all greed and false satisfactions to feed on that true and living bread which you have given us in your incarnate word. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the scripture readings.
The Old Testament reading is taken from Hosea chapter 11, and I read from verses 1 to 11. God's love for Israel. When Israel was a child, I loved her, and out of Egypt, I called my son. But the more they were called, the more they went away from me. They sacrificed to the Baals, and they burned incense to images. It was I who taught Ephraim to walk, taking them by the arms, but they did not realize it was I who healed them. I led them with the cord of human kindness, with ties of love. To them, I was like the one who lives, a child to the cheek, and I bent down to feed them. Will they not return to Egypt, and will not Assyria rule over them, because they refuse to repent? A sword will flash in their city. It will devour their false prophets and put an end to their plans. My people are determined to turn from me, even though they call me God Most High. I will by no means exalt them. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over to Israel? How can I treat you like Admah? How can I make you like Zeboiim? My heart is changed within me, and all my compassion is aroused. I will not carry out my fierce anger, nor will I devastate Ephraim again. For I am God and not a man, the Holy One among you. I will not come against their city. They will follow the Lord. He will roar like a lion. When he roars, his children will come trembling from the west. They will come from Egypt, trembling like sparrows, from Assyria, fluttering like doves. I will settle them in their homes, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Shall we all stand for the reading of the psalm?
Our reading for today is taken from Psalm 107, verses 1 to 9 and verse 43. Let us read alternatively. Give thanks to the Lord because he is good. His love is eternal. And has brought you back from foreign countries, from east and west, from north and south. They were hungry and thirsty and had given up all hope. He led them by a straight road to a city where they could live. He satisfies those who are thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Verse 43. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, now and ever.
Amen. Thank you.
Please be seated for the New Testament reading.
The epistle is taken from Colossians chapter 3, reading from verses 1 to 11. Since you became alive again, certainly speak. When Christ arose from the dead, now set your sights on the rich treasures and joys of heaven, where he sits beside God in the place of honor and power. Let heaven fill your thoughts. Don't spend your time worrying about things down here. You should have as little desire for this world as a dead person does. Your real life is in heaven with Christ and God. And when Christ, who is our real life, comes back again, you will shine with him and share in all his glory. Away then with sinful earthly things, deaden the evil desires lurking within you. It has nothing to do with sexual sin, impurity, lust, and shameful desires. Don't worship the good things of life, for that is idolatry. For terrible anger is upon those who do such things. You used to do this when your life was still part of this world. But now is the time to cast off and throw away all these rotten garments of anger, hatred, cursing, and dirty language. Don't tell lies to each other. It was your old life with all its wickedness that did that sort of thing. Now it is dead and gone. You are living a brand new kind of life that is continually learning more and more of what is right and trying constantly to be more and more like Christ, who created this new life within you. In this new life, one's nationality or race or education or social position is unimportant. Such things mean nothing. Whether a person has Christ is what matters, and he is equally available to all. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks. Shall we all rise and sing hymn number 485, 485.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Father, Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us to your house once again. Lord, as we look into your word, we pray, Lord, that you will speak to us, that your Holy Spirit will reveal the truths in your scriptures to us, and Lord, that he will open our hearts and our ears and our eyes to see what you have to say to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today is MCC Sunday, and the theme for today is follow the Bible to store up treasures in heaven. Follow the Bible to store up treasures in heaven. In the world around us, we have so much of social media, television, internet, smartphones. They all advertise so many things, enticing us to buy different products, to get more things that is offered in this world. Even when we travel on the road, we see advertisements. Even society itself our friends, others around us, promote various things and encourage us directly or indirectly to get more stuff that is available in this world. Sometimes we ourselves advertise different things. We might wear Nike shoe, Nike t-shirt promoting a brand. We might wear a certain type of shirt, or we might drive a certain type of car that makes other people want to get those things as well. If we really look back into our lives, into our homes, have we gathered so much of things? We might see that we have stored up a lot of worldly things. We need one wristwatch, but we might own two or three. We might need one car, but we may have two cars at home. Some ladies, if you ask them how many pairs of shoes they have, they'll say, I don't have enough shoes. But they may have about 10 to 15 pairs of shoes. But this is the reality we are living in. We live in a world where everything is telling us to get more. And whether you're rich or poor, if you really look at the stuff that you have more than what you really need. You may lack in some areas, but in some things you have more than what you need. And this is what the Bible talks about as greed and covetousness. And the biblical definition of covetousness is to have a strong desire to find fulfillment in worldly things rather than finding fulfillment in God. A strong desire to find fulfillment in worldly things than to find fulfillment in God. In other words, giving importance to worldly things more than giving importance to godly things is covetousness. Do not covet, one of the Ten Commandments. And if you really study the Ten Commandments, you will see almost all Ten Commandments touch on do not covet. For example, do not steal. That is, we should not covet someone else's things and take them. Do not commit adultery. Do not covet someone else's spouse. So coveting is a big problem. Greed is a big problem, and we all are caught in this trap, in this world. If you listen to all four readings today, that is the main theme in our readings. It talks of two main things. It talks of how we are drawn away from God because of our desire for worldly things. And it also talks of how we should store up treasures in heaven. And in the gospel reading for today, we see Jesus talking to thousands of people. And one man comes and asks him, Rabbi, can you be the arbiter or be the lawyer for me to divide my inheritance with my brother? And in reply to that, Jesus tells a short parable. This parable, although it's short, really speaks to us. And even as I was preparing for this sermon, the word challenged me and pushed me to change things in my life. And I hope today that this message and this passage of scripture will challenge you to change certain things in your life. In the gospel reading, in verse 16, Jesus tells the crowd, there was a rich man who received an enormous harvest, and he was wondering in his mind, what should I do, or how should I deal with this extra crops? And he's thinking, okay, I have large storehouses, but maybe I can break them down and build bigger ones so I can store up all these crops. And if I store up more crops, that means I can have an easy life after that. I can eat, drink, and be merry. He only thought about himself. He only thought about expanding his business. But in that parable, God tells this man, you fool, today you will die, and someone else will get all that you have stored up. Someone else will get all these treasures, and you will not get anything. God calls this man a fool, not because he was wise to store up treasures, not because he was smart and wealthy, not because he was rich, but because he did not take the trouble to think about his soul, to think about the important things of God, to think about what will happen after he dies. If we honestly look at ourselves, we may not be any better than this rich man. So today, let us look at a few important truths from this parable, what we can take for our lives. First, we see in this parable, the rich man, he gets his crop, he gets his money from the ground. It's coming from God. And in our lives, we might think that we are working hard and earning a lot of money, but we need to know that that is also what God is giving us. However hard we work, however educated we are, we do not get because of our own strength. It is because God is blessing us. And in this parable, this man doesn't bother to even give 10%. He doesn't bother to give his tithes. If you read it carefully, the first thing he thinks of is how can he build bigger storehouses to store his crops. Are we the same? Do we give our 10%? Do we give our tithes to God? Is that the first thing we do when we get our salary, when we get some money, when we get an income? Do we first set aside the 10% to God? Now, some people think giving to the poor is giving the tithes. Giving to God means you bring it to the church. Giving to God means you give it to missions. You give it to a Christian work, giving money to the spread of the gospel. That is where our tithe should go. Some people think, oh, giving 10% tithing is an Old Testament teaching, and it is not for the New Testament or not for us. There's nothing further from the truth than that. The New Testament tells us to give everything to God, not only the 10%, but the 100%. So at least we should be giving our 10%. Giving our tithes to God is honoring God in our finances, honoring God with our income. So let's ask ourselves the question, do we prioritize faithfully giving our tithes to God? Do we prioritize giving money to missions and the work of the kingdom? Secondly, the rich man is immediately thinking about expanding his business. He's thinking, okay, I have storehouses, but my storehouse is not enough to store the crops, so I need to build bigger ones. We don't see him being even thankful to God. We don't see him thinking about other people. We can't see him thinking about the poor. But he is very concerned about his business and his income. Are we like that? Is that what is our main focus in our lives? About how we are going to get the next promotion, about how we are going to increase our business, about how we are going to invest our money in the stock exchange or in that bank for a better return? Is that all that we are thinking of? See, the Bible doesn't tell us that it is wrong to be rich, doesn't tell us it is wrong to plan. It is good. We need to think about our future. We need to think about plans. We need to save money. We need to plan for emergency situations that may come up in the future. But at the same time, we need to think about others. We need to think about the mission. We need to think about the church. For example, in this church, we focus a lot about the building, the rewiring, the cutting of trees, the painting of the buildings. And those are very good and important things to continue the church and for the safety of the people. But how much time and effort do we spend in thinking about spiritual things in the church? How much of programs we have for Bible study, for prayer meetings, for missions? Let's ask ourselves the question. Do we give priority to spiritual growth of the church and the expansion of God's kingdom? Thirdly, we see in this rich man, his desire is to earn enough money so he can relax. To earn more and more so he can eat, drink, and be merry. This is burning desire. Some of us might take up two jobs so that we can earn more money. Some of us might want to do a part-time second job or work overtime so we can earn more money, save more money. Are we working too hard? We don't have time for church. We don't have time for God. We don't have time to read the Bible. We don't have time to mix with others who are doing God's work, to support them, to pray for them, because we are so busy earning. We are so busy with the world things, we don't have time to think about our own spiritual lives, and the spiritual lives of our brothers and sisters. We are so busy. If we are to die today, we are not ready to meet our Creator. As Christians, we must live as though we are ready to die any moment. We must be ready to meet our Lord and Savior, our Creator, any moment. And we know that. We know that from our friends and people around us, how death just comes on us suddenly. It doesn't give us a warning. Sometimes it does, but most of the time it doesn't. It comes by surprise. You are not ready. You don't have time to prepare. So we must be ready all the time. Is our interest focused on earning and worldly things? Or do we give enough importance to our spiritual lives? Let us ask today this question. Do we obey God and live according to His word? Or are we running after worldly pleasures? The gospel reading for today. The passage just after our reading tells us this. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, or about your body, what you will wear. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothes. Consider the ravens, they do not sow or reap. They have no storeroom or barn, yet God feeds them. And how much more valuable are you than these birds? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to your life? Since you cannot do this very little thing, why do you worry about the rest? Consider how the wildflowers grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you, not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, how much more will He clothe you, you of little faith?" And do not set your heart on what you will eat or drink. Do not worry about it. For the pagan world runs after all such things. And your Father knows that you need them. But seek His kingdom, and these things will be given to you as well. Our God knows our needs. He provides for us. We do not have to toil and labor so much. We do not have to store up things in our houses and in our bank accounts so much that we don't trust in God anymore. Our God knows our needs. He supplies our needs. He cares for us. If He cares for the grass and the flowers and the birds, how much more does He care for us? Even in our context today, in our country, we have so much people grumbling and complaining and whining. And there is a lot of reason for them to do that. But as Christians, can we grumble and whine when God has blessed us so much? When God has promised us so much? He died for us on the cross so that we will be saved, and blessed us so much. And He has promised to look after us, to provide all our needs. Where is our focus today? Where is our heart today? The Bible says, "Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Where is your treasure? Is your treasure on worldly things, on success, on promotions, on going to this university and that? Is society pushing you to do things that you don't want, competing with others? Where is it? So how can we apply this to our lives? First of all, we need to see that Jesus is giving us a strong warning. In this passage, Jesus says, watch out, be on your guard against greed and covetousness, because the world around us is trying its best to move us away from God. We need to set our hearts and minds on things above and not on earthly things. It is a decision that we need to make. We need to decide. We need to choose. We need to say, no, I am going to focus on godly things. I am going to serve the church. I am going to keep to missions. I am going to spend more time in the Word of God. Spend more time in activities in the church, in spiritual things. I'm going to spend more time sharing about God with others. And to sum up this, I'd like to share a small extract from the opening message delivered by the Archbishop of Canterbury on the first day of the Lambeth Conference. He spoke this to over 600 bishops and their spouses and the other visitors. He said, my prayer is this, that whoever you are and whatever hopes and fears you may have, that you will receive a heart full of desire for friendship with Jesus. My prayer is that you will receive a heart full of desire for friendship with Jesus. To desire Jesus is to desire God. To desire Jesus is to desire to be filled with the love of God, love for his people, and love for his world. I'll say that again. To desire Jesus is to be filled with the love for God, love for his people, and love for his world. Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, for the strong warning that you have given us to remind each one of us. Not to get caught up in this worldly system and to desire things of this earth as if we are going to live here forever. Thank you for the warning and the reminder that you want us to focus on our eternity, what will happen to us after we die. We thank you, Lord. Lord, help us to turn from these worldly ways, to focus on you, to turn our eyes to you. We ask this in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Shall we spend a moment in silence and think about how we can apply this to our lives? shall we arise and affirm our faith by singing the Nicene Creed together. The congregation's response will be, hear our prayer. For a just peace and harmony in all of creation, the liberation of all people everywhere, and the integrity
and welfare of God's holy church. Lord, in your mercy. Let us pray for the church, especially here in Sri Lanka. We pray that the Holy Spirit will sustain the church and help us and help all those who work in the church as clergy and lay people to serve in God's mission, that they may be agents of God's love and presence amongst the broken and wounded in society. By your grace, Lord, help us to be a church in our context. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for all those around the world who are afflicted by various illnesses. And we pray for those who help them, who care for them, for all healthcare workers who risk their own safety to protect others. Lord Jesus, may your healing embrace be with all those who are sick, and may the grace of your resurrection be upon all who are mentally down. May you strengthen all those who serve selflessly for the welfare of others, following your example of love. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Let us pray for God's creation in the context of global warming and climate change, amidst the realities of us abusing this gift of creation. Creator God, we come to you seeking a renewal of heart and mind. Help us to love our neighbor. Help us to love nature, your creation. Help us to love all those who live on this, your earth. Help us to reimagine our duty as stewards of your creation. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
We pray for our metropolitan, our bishops, and all the bishops who are attending the Lambeth Conference. We pray for the lay workers in our church, the leaders and clergy of the churches around the world. We pray that they may serve with courage, humility, and compassion in your example. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O good and gracious God, we come with joyful hearts of expectation, offering prayers to you for unity, strength, and great success at the end of the conference. As the bishops of your church gather to seek your direction and to share with each other, to carry out your will, we pray that you continue to fill them with the spirit of love that is manifested and transformed in the lives of these shepherds and the flock to whom they minister. Lord, it is our plea that the transformed children of your kingdom, through missionary zeal, seek to transform others by your love flowing through us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for our nation. We pray that you will guide our leaders and show them the right decisions to make, that they will not make decisions selfishly, but will make decisions for the betterment of the nation. We pray that you will guide them and lead them, and that they will not seek for guidance from other people, because only you can give them the real
true guidance and show them what they are to do. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
That with all those who have passed to full communion in Christ and the saints, that we may enter into the fullness of that unending joy. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of your kingdom, and grant that we and all your servants, being strengthened together in the eternal fellowship of the Holy Spirit, may with joy behold your Son at his coming again in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
We all stand for the greeting of peace. The Lord be with you. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. Acts chapter 2. Verse 44 and 45. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Shall we sing hymn number 404? 404 as our opportunity hymn.
Thank you.
we say the offertory prayer together found on page 34. All things come from you, and in all things we do, we open and love our family again. Let our work by the Holy Spirit. Page 36. O Lord, be with you. And a good and joyful thing. Always, and every right to give thanks to you, gracious Father, creator of heaven and earth. And now we give you thanks because you sent your only begotten, the Lord Jesus Christ, to reconcile the world to you, and through Christ sent witnesses in the power of the Spirit to preach the gospel and to gather together a community of love that call upon your name in every place and every age. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy indeed are you, gracious Father, eternal sovereign, who in all your gifts and works manifest your holiness in all humanity. Holy is your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, through whom you did order the universe. And holy is your ever-blessed Spirit, who reveals all things, even the deep things of you, O God. Just as you yourself are holy, you also created us in your own image, that we might live in holy fellowship. And when we disobeyed your commandments, you did not abandon us, but you guided us as a merciful Father. You revealed yourself to us through the sages, the law, and the prophets, and through your redeeming acts in history. And when the time was ripe, you came among us through your Son Jesus, whom you sent into the world to share our human nature, in order that the Lord Jesus might revive your own image in us.
Jesus loves us and sacrificed himself for us, and heralded new life in breaking bread with companions.
On the very night that he was betrayed to suffer death upon the cross for us, the Lord Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, Almighty Father, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, after supper, he took the cup also. And after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink all of you from this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith.
Live by resurrection and await your coming again.
And so, Father, we present this bread and cup in communion with your whole church, in fellowship with all the saints, and in union with all creation. We celebrate your Son's death and victory, giving thanks for all that Christ has done for us, for preparing us for all that lies ahead, as we receive the benefits of Christ's life, death, resurrection, and session in glory, and we eagerly await the heavenly banquet after Christ's coming again. And we entreat you, most merciful God, to hear us and send your all Holy Spirit on us, and on these your gifts, that they being blessed and hallowed by that life-giving power, may be for us the body and blood of your most dearly loved Son, to the end that we receiving the same may be sanctified and filled with your grace and heavenly blessings.
Accept this sacrifice
and thanksgiving. Make us one body in Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be to you, Almighty Father, world without end. Amen.
The bread which we break, is it not a sharing in the body of Christ?
We being many are one bread, one body, for we all partake of the one bread.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. the gifts for God, for the people of God. Take this holy sacrament to your comfort.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Thank you.
Page 56. Give thanks to the Lord, for God is gracious.
God's mercy endures forever.
Luke chapter 12, verse 33 says, sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourselves that will not wear out, a treasure in heaven that will never fail, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. Almighty God, we thank you for filling us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through Christ, we offer you ourselves to the living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit and to the grace and glory. Notices. Mothers Union monthly meeting will be held on Sunday, the 7th of August, after the divine service at the church hall. Members, please be present. The message will be given by Mrs. Irene Shirenganathan, the branch leader. The evaluation examination will be held on Sunday, the 7th August, from 9 a.m. to 12 noon for those who are doing their exams. Notice is also given of the special general meeting of Holy Trinity Church, Vallavatta. It will be held soon after the divine service on Sunday, the 14th of August, in our parish hall. The notice of same and the agenda is posted on the church notice board. Those who have any questions regarding the resolution of becoming a province, may please hand over your questions to me after the divine service. Today is the last chance. Let us spend a moment in silence as we remember our dear brother, Ravi Arunakam, Arunakam. Loving Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the life of our dear brother Ravi. We thank you, Lord, for all that he has been to us, his church, to his family. We thank you, Lord, that you have blessed him and blessed so many through him. Lord, we also pray for his family and loved ones, and his son who are saddened by their loss. Comfort them and be with them. In Jesus' name we pray. Birthdays this week, Master Jaden celebrates his birthday. Let us also pray for him. Heavenly Father, we pray for Jaden as he celebrates his birthday this week. We pray, Lord, that you will guide him, strengthen him, draw him close to you. But we pray, Lord, that in all his decisions in life, as he grows up, his education, that he will give you the first place. Lord, we pray for all those others in our parish who are celebrating anniversaries or birthdays. God bless them and provide for them. We also pray for all those who are sick in our parish. God, we pray, Lord, for a divine hand of healing to touch them and restore them back to good health. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us continue to be in prayer. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Shall we all stand? Go in peace to serve and love the Lord. Shall we sing hymn number 376? 376.